Hey guys, what we're seeing here is a technique called billboarding. The idea is to render a textured quad and make it always point towards the viewer. In mathematical terms, this basically means that the vector from the viewer to the quad must always be perpendicular to the face of the quad. Now, you can probably implement this using the tools that we already have, but it becomes much easier using a shader stage in the 3D pipeline that we haven't used so far, the geometry shader. Before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Evgen, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLdev or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. Back to the geometry shader. This shader stage is located between the vertex shader and the fragment shader. The motivation behind the geometry shader, aka the GS, is to overcome the limitations of the existing architecture, so let's talk about these limitations. First of all, the vertex shader always outputs a single vertex. It cannot drop the vertex if it wants to, nor can it create new vertices. The geometry shader can do both. You can decide to get rid of the vertex entirely, and you can also create new geometry by outputting multiple primitives for every vertex. The number of output primitives is dynamic, so you can output a single triangle on one vertex and three triangles on another. Combining this with another feature of OpenGL called transform feedback makes the GS very useful for particle systems, which we will see in the future. Second, the vertex shader doesn't know which triangle the current vertex belongs to. A vertex may be shared between several triangles, which makes it even more difficult to know the context using the existing tools. The vertex shader cannot access the information in the other two vertices of the triangle. The geometry shader solves this problem by providing the shader code with access to the attributes of all the vertices in the primitive. This basically means that the GS is executed once per primitive, and so the context that it sees is the entire primitive, rather than a single vertex like the vertex shader. This makes it easier to implement techniques such as the silhouette detection of an object. And finally, the geometry shader unlocks the potential of a set of new topology types that provide access to the adjacent vertices of the current primitive, which provides even more contextual information to the GS. This capability is also useful for silhouette detection, which will also be covered in a future video. Now, remember that the GS is an optional shader stage. Without it, the pipeline assembles the output of the vertex shader into complete primitives and passes them on to the rasterizer. When the GS is active, it explicitly outputs zero or more primitives, and these primitives reach the rasterizer, so everything after the GS continues as usual. To understand the mechanics of the geometry shader, let's see a simple demonstration of its strength. We usually calculate the normal vector offline and transform it in the vertex shader using a matrix to the coordinate system where light calculations take place. But what should we do if the vertex position is transformed using a different method, one which cannot be expressed using a matrix? In the following example, the original model is just a simple grid. In the vertex shader, we calculate the distance from the vertex to some center point and update the y-coordinate using the sine function on that distance. There is also a time component to make the new location dynamic from frame to frame. This creates the wave effect that we can see here. Notice that each vertex is translated a bit differently, which means that we don't know exactly where the normal of each triangle points to. The geometry shader is extremely useful here because it allows us to simply calculate the normal based on the transformed vertices from the vertex shader. Before we jump into the GS code, notice that there is also a texture coordinate which we need to send down the pipeline. We usually do this using a simple out attribute, but in this case the output attributes, except the GL position, are wrapped inside what is called an interface block, which allows us to send all these attributes in a single structure. We will need this in the GS because we need to access the attributes of each vertex independently. Before we can start using the GS, we have to compile and attach it to the shader program as any other shader. Therefore, during the initialization of the technique, I've added a call to addShader, which takes the special OpenGL enum of the GS, GL Geometry Shader, along with the file name of the GS. This is the same old function that I've been using for the vertex and fragment shaders. It creates the shader object, loads the shader source into it, compiles the shader, and attaches it to the shader program. No problem so far. The GS itself is written in GLSL as usual, but there are a few special keywords that provide it with important information. First of all, we must declare the input primitive type. The available options here are points, lines, lines with adjacency, triangles, and triangles with adjacency. Next, we have the output primitive type. This is limited to points, line strip, or triangle strip. The idea behind the two strip topologies is that the first two or three vertices create a line or a triangle, and then the next vertex joins the last one or two vertices to create a new line or a triangle. In this demo, we just need to output a single triangle for each input triangle, so we use the triangle strip. And finally, we have to declare the maximum number of vertices that this geometry shader can output. This is important for the shader compiler because the dynamic nature of the GS presents a challenge to shader compilation. We can get the maximum number supported by the current platform by querying for GL max geometry output vertices, but this value is guaranteed to be at least 256, so we have plenty of room here. In the main shader function, we begin by extracting the transformed position of the three vertices. This is available using the internal array glin. This array also contains a point size and a clip distance, but we will not be using these today. We can now calculate two edges of the triangle and get the normal vector using the cross product. We are now ready to start outputting vertices. This is done by setting GL position as well as the regular output attributes. Every time we call emit vertex, one output vertex is generated based on the current value of the output attributes. Since the position in this demo is given in world space, we just need to multiply it by the view projection matrix. This must be done once for each vertex. We have a declaration of an input interface block, which corresponds to the output interface block from the vertex shader. For each output vertex, we copy the texture coordinates from the input to the output. Notice that the normal is the same for all vertices, so it's enough to update it only once. After emitting the three vertices, we have to call end primitive to indicate that we have completed a single output primitive. From now on, everything continues as usual. The fragment shader receives the texture coordinates and the normal vector, and uses them to sample from the texture and calculate the fuse lighting. Now let's jump into the billboarding demo. The way that this technique works is that the application only needs to render points. Each point is provided in world space coordinates and indicates where the billboard is supposed to be created in the world. We will provide a camera position in the world to the GS, and it will calculate the vector from the camera to the current point. Assuming that we want the billboard to stand upright, we can do a cross product between the standard up vector 010 and the camera to point vector. This will create a right vector, which is perpendicular to the plane created by the up vector and the camera to point vector. Very confusing, and I hope I got it right. Correct. Just remember that this is a left-handed coordinate system, so you may need to reverse a few things to make it work in a right-handed system. We can now use this vector in order to create a quad, using the original point as the bottom left corner of the quad. The front-facing triangles are configured to be clockwise, so we use this vector to go up to the top left corner, then to the right and down to the bottom right corner. This is the first triangle. Remember that this is a triangle strip, so we can now go up to the top right corner, and this final point will create a second triangle along with the last two vertices. Now let's jump into the code and see this in action. The vertex shader is as short as it can be. It simply passes along the position of the point without any changes. In the JS, we define the input primitive type to be points. The output is a triangle strip, and we have four output vertices for our quad. We extract the position of the point, calculate the vector from the camera to the point, and the cross product between the up vector and camera to point vector provides the right vector. From now on, we simply repeat the steps that we saw in the diagram. The first point is the original one. Then we go up, then down and to the right, and finally up. Remember that we have to transform each vertex by the view projection matrix and call emit vertex. Also notice that for each vertex, we manually set the textural coordinates to fully cover the texture: 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. This completes the geometry shader. In the fragment shader, we just need to sample the color from the texture. Notice that we are also checking whether the color is entirely black or white, depending on the specific texture. I'm actually using two textures in this demo. One has a black background and the other has white, so to get rid of the background, we need to check for the correct color and use the special GLSL keyword discard in order to drop the current fragment entirely. And that is it. There are more usages of the geometry shader, which we will definitely explore in the future. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.